Thank you, sir.
Guys, we're getting ready to go live. Here we go.
Let's do this.
I think. Thank you for joining Auto Network Live. I'm your host, Roosevelt, and we will take you inside the auto industry like never before. And we will take you inside the fitness industry today like never before with one of our good friends, Mr. Kamatne Rollins. We have on the show today, we have Russ Heaps out of Greenville, South Carolina, Frank Washington, Detroit, and Greg Morrison. Where are you today, Greg? I mean, Frank. Greg, where are you?
Oh, I think my name is Greg, and I'm at Lake Lanier for the Gamma family.
We lost you.
I'm in Lake Lanier, Georgia.
Okay.
He's there for the family car challenge that Gamma does every year.
Oh, that's right. That's what those pictures you sent me on my cell phone, and I didn't have enough time to move them over where we could see them as you talk, Greg. But anyway, I have a couple of announcements to make, and then we'll have Mr. Kamatne Rollins on to talk a little bit about whatever he wants to talk about today. But anyway, we have a new newspaper that's carrying our video, the Charlotte Post, finally. They will have the playlist for the show. So every time we do a show, it'll automatically post on the Charlotte Post website. The detailed walkarounds that I do once a week will automatically post on their website. So I think that gives us about 7 or 8 African-American newspapers that's carrying our video content. So we're a little light since there are 200 of them. We have a ways to go yet. So, but anyway, as Russ told me earlier, how do you eat an elephant? One bite at a time. That's what I have to do with these people. A couple of promotions that I missed. General Motors has appointed Phil Brooks to the new position of Vice President of Marketing. He will introduce the redesigned Enclave and the redesigned Regal. I don't know when those events are coming up or if we've missed them already. And Mazda appoints Dino Bernacchi to a newly created Chief Marketing Officer. And this is going to be interesting. It's a newly created position. He will review customer interactions from shopping to purchase and ownership. Whatever that means. And he's trying to move Mazda into the premium market or the premium marketplace. So it's going to be interesting to see how he ties all of that, how all of that ties together.
It sounds like he's somebody's brother-in-law and they created a job for him. All that gobbledygook sounds like to me, but that's just me.
Well, I didn't want to really get into that, but anyway, that's his new position. I don't know either of those guys. I don't know whether you all either. But Greg, why don't you briefly tell us about where you are, what you're doing, and then we'll have let Kamatne have the rest of the show.
Okay, I'm in Lake Lanier, Georgia, for the Greater Atlanta Automotive Media Association annual Family Car Challenge. We basically take a lot of sedans, crossovers, SUVs, and some pickup trucks, and assess them as to whether or not they really make sense for a family. We rate them, judge them, and make awards, which will be tomorrow. So this afternoon and tomorrow, a lot of members are already here starting to drive the cars, make notes on them, and see what's working and what's not. It sounds like a fun day, but it is serious work when you're trying to keep the cars straight as to which one you shot or which one you drove. We have everything from the luxury brands, Lexus and Julia from Alpha, down to the Prius Prime, and even Hyundai brought in their all-electric Ioniq version for us to take a look at. So it's going to be a fun day, and it's a chance for all of us to get together, all of the manufacturers, reps, as well as the fleet managers, to get together, compare notes, and really drive these cars over the same road around the same time to get an apples-to-apples comparison.
So is that where Chris is today?
Yes, El Presidente is in a board meeting right now as we're just handling the last bit of details for the event. And, you know, it's always a lot of last minute details, making sure the car's in the right place. And of course, they just detailed all the cars here. And then it started to rain.
Oh, man. About how many cars are there?
When I left, there were about 30 cars out there, and more were coming in.
And how much time do you have in each car?
Normally, you get about 20, 25 minutes, just take it for a quick spin. But then again, you also have a chance, like I came in early today, to get some looks at some vehicles that I hadn't seen before, so I could get some up close and personal time. And you're looking for features, functionality, how easy is it to get in and out? Does it work for a family? Does it work for folks with child seats or elderly relatives who may be in wheelchairs or need assistance getting in and out of the cars? And even you, Russ.
I was going to say, you've got the elderly thing pretty well covered, I'm guessing. But, are they using? Does everybody have you climb in and out of all the cars so they can get your evaluation on it?
Yes, I'm called the Russ Heaps model this year.
Excellent.
Great, Greg. Hang around and finish the show.
Will do.
Great. I appreciate it. Okay. Our special guest today is Kamotney Rollins. I knew Kamotney when he was an intern, as a matter of fact, with his dad many, many years ago with what was that, African American on Wheels publication. And I've watched him grow. We've had many conversations over the years. I've seen him become an interesting journalist, to say the least, automotive journalist. So I know, like I said, I knew him when. So if he tries to pull the fast one on us today, I can correct him. I can remember when he was a meat eater, y'all, just like the rest of us. So, but he's become, one thing I can say, I knew him before he had kids. He's become a very, very loving and dedicated father. I can say that about him. We've had some conversations about family. I can say he's become a fine journalist. And I can also say on the auto side, the market that he went after, which was pretty much the hip hop back in those days, that he was a very astute businessman. So he did use his training from Georgia Tech, to do the things that he can do, that he's doing right now. So I want to commend him and his parents for keeping him on the straight and narrow. And look at where he is now. I remember when he had hair. But anyway. So anyway, come on, tell us a little bit about how you started with Automotive Rhythms, and what we really want to talk about today is Fit Fathers. Take it away.
First of all, thanks for that amazing introduction. I definitely appreciate that. And as with all things, you know, maturity will certainly take over any inexperiences. So it's been an amazing journey from the beginning of my automotive career to the onset of Fit Fathers. And I've always acknowledged my peers and my leaders and listening. You know, in entrepreneurship, you have to listen more than anything else. And that's one of the strong suits that I've learned from my father, who started African Americans on Wheels. And set trends then, and hopefully continue to set trends. So, you know, Automotive Rhythms is a lifestyle automotive media platform. Our goal is to educate consumers on vehicle technology, test drives, green car vehicles, as well as safety hazards, what's going on in the automotive industry. And we do that through a lifestyle platform. We want to be able to reach consumers where they commune, where they congregate and step into their environment with these new vehicle products. So we've been very successful doing that with launches such as Super Bowls, NBA All-Star Weekends, Kentucky Derbies, and even down to just local events like VIP dinners with, you know, a celebrity, et cetera, with a luxury brand and some of their guests and friends. You know, so the idea is to really take the messaging from the automotive company, pit that against the consumer they're trying to reach, and then create an environment which is conducive to both. So you're always thinking, you're always elevating, you're always conspiring. It's always work to be done. It's never a dull moment. So it's just been a blessing to be able to develop relationships, because that's what successful business is all about, being able to tap into the right individuals and have them make quick decisions on your behalf. And if you can get, 10 to 15% of yeses over no's, then you're doing a pretty good job, especially in our industry where there are a lot of no's. So we want to be, in all platforms where people receive information. So it started as an editorial website, but of course we quickly branched out to social media, television. We were shooting Automotive Rhythm TV episodes before the advent of YouTube. So, we was in the forefront, like yourself, Roosevelt, on video technology, with how people receive information and how they view cars. So the goal was to always stay on top of the technology and the trends and the flow with that. Social media is very heavy right now. But even that is evolving. It's taking a little bit more readjustment, because, now everything is paid social media campaigns, and the views are being taken away from the organic views. So it's always a challenge. But I'm up for challenges. That's something my father instilled in me, my mother. Never let anyone get you down. Keep fighting to the end. And my thing is to make sure that clients are happy, partners are happy, and consumers are happy. So I don't rest until I see that, the job is fully communicated. And that's what makes me feel good about continuing on this road to entrepreneurship.
I'll talk a little bit about how Fit Fathers came about and how you've managed to grow it into the success that it is now.
Well, it's interesting. As I said, I played football at Georgia Tech. So, of course, I was always a supreme athlete. But then you had training, you had resources, you had direction. So once I graduated, I kind of lost my way. Of course, these very amazing and entertaining press launches, traveling the world, eating whatever, drinking whatever. It can have a negative effect on individuals if their character isn't strong enough. And me, I was always the life of the party. I wanted to be the one that kind of led the troops. And I just kind of got in over my head and gained about 50 pounds. And one day I just, I had to talk with myself. I'm a very spiritual individual. So if I feel as though I'm not in tune with society, with the universe spiritually, and that's when I make changes. And I saw that I was running into a lot of obstacles, and I wanted to change that into a more positive flow. And I actually used myself as a barometer, and also the support of the auto companies, and seeing what type of resources they had, and thinking to myself, well, if I can help them, change what they present to us, then we'll all be a little bit better. Because it's one thing to make a decision for self and say, hey, I'm going to do this. But it's another when someone else in your environment says, no, we're doing this. And when you're a guest and you're being hosted by another brand, sometimes you have to defer to their means and their methods. So I decided to run a half marathon, and I've never run more than a mile in my life. I've always been a sprinter. And I was like, I'm going to just do it. And I started training, and everything led back to nutrition, how you fuel your body, just like how you fuel your vehicle to get top performance out of it. And I started changing my diet, less processed foods, more whole foods, which is fruits, vegetables, whole grains. And I just started feeling better. And by the time the half marathon came about, I had lost like 45 pounds. So now I'm back down on my high school weight, and it felt great. And I wanted to keep it off. And one thing about dieting is that, if you do it too soon, cut too many corners, you gain the weight back. So I wanted to make it a lifestyle change, not so much a diet. And I kind of stuck with it, and I felt more energy. I felt spiritually blessed, and more positivity to want to help others. So I used the platform Fit Fathers to educate, some of my colleagues, such as yourselves, some of the PR individuals at the auto companies. And then gradually you started seeing changes. You know, there was all of a sudden hummus and veggies, you know, at the lunches, fresh fruits, you know, more kale. So it's been a blessing to see how I went from that to this, and created a community where people can come and be inspired while receiving information as well. So the Fit Fathers brand is a website as well as a series of events where we go into communities and lead free workouts, what we call social workouts. We never want to charge anyone because it's challenging enough for individuals to say, hey, I want to change my life. Once you add some dollar signs to that, you totally lose them. So, you know, we're supported by donations and sponsorships so we can continue to educate with our cadre of fitness trainers. And we go into communities and we help inspire individuals. And we've had partnerships from the White House to Nike, you know, to Children's Hospital. And our big event is Fit Father's Day, which takes place on Father's Day. And it's in its fourth year. Last year, we had over 500 people come and attend. And it was just amazing. This big group workout, and then everyone is eating fresh fruits and drinking water and vitamin and coconut water and just living very energetically. And that's kind of the goal as we try to fight the offset of chronic disease, which especially in the Black community affects us disproportionately than it does the general population.
Right. One thing I've always said to people who go on these junkets like we do, you have more food to eat and you have more than you can ever drink. So you have the greatest, you have the greatest risk of being overweight and an alcoholic simultaneously without you spending a dime. So, so I can appreciate the fact that you could push, you know, things away from the table. And I know you gave a lot of us grief, and a lot of us don't like you today, but because of that, trying to make us eat hummus and getting really the car companies to change the diet instead of meals. I want my steak. I don't care what Kamani said. I want my steak. I believe it. What about eating in moderation, man? Do I have to become a vegan to drop 45 pounds?
Not at all. Listen, you know, well, I will say when I first turned vegan, you know, I was a little over the top, as most of us are when they ascertain new information. But right currently, we're all individuals. Y'all have our own set of requirements, just like the various cars that we drive have their own requirements. So what I say is whatever you do eat, just increase the amount of vegetables, specifically the cruciferous vegetables, which is your kale, your asparagus, you know, your leafy green vegetables, because, you know, they have more phytochemicals, more antioxidants to fight off the free radicals that lead to the chronic diseases such as cancers and heart disease and diabetes. So, you know, you can eat your crap, Roosevelt, but you know what I mean?
Well, one more question, and I have the guys to jump in. How did you come up with the name Fit Fathers?
You know what? I've always been a poet. I used to freestyle in high school and college, so that's actually how I came up with Automotive Rhythms, too. I was trying to think of a car column that had rhythm, and then my wife was like, no, you're going a little bit too deep. Just call it Automotive Rhythm. And I was like, all right. So the same thing with Fit Fathers. You know, my father, Randy, he was a poet, you know, and I always had, you know, very interesting wordplay. So I figured it had to be a catchy name, and always like, you know, always like the names, you know, starting with the same letters, you know, with short names. So we just threw out Fit Fathers after like, you know, 10 tries, and everyone just flowed with it. Just sounded right. It looked right on social media. It was nice and short and concise for the website. And now it's a brand name. You know, I go places and people like, yo, Fit Fathers, what's up? So it just feels good when you create a brand and then that brand becomes respected by individuals, the most least likely individuals.
Right. Question?
Well, yeah, I've got one. yes, as Roosevelt said, you have dogged some of us out about our dining choices over the years, but I mean, it is good advice. When you talk to people about changing lifestyles, changing diet, after the initial pushback, what are you hearing back?
Well, the challenging thing is that for most people, they start off as a finite outreach, but it turns out to be temporary, and that's the challenge for them. And they go hard for a few days, a few weeks, and then it dissipates. So what I tell them is that you have to change your brain, you have to change your mind, change the way you think. You have to unlearn everything that we've learned about the food industry, because the majority of it is lies. So reading and documentary watching is going to be your two key assets, you know, so that way your mind becomes familiar with some of these terms and some of these lifestyle habits, to the point where cognitively you don't have to think about it when you're making a choice. Now it's like, if you see the chips and you see the grapes, actually I got a bowl of grapes right here, you know.
And where's ours?
Hey, why can't I have both?
You can just have more. Just have more of the fiber.
Okay.
So yeah, I tell them to educate themselves first, and that makes the decision-making process that much easier. But it's going to take time. It took me like a full 3 years to get to the state where I am now, and where everyone sees me, you know, vigilant when it comes to choices. It was a struggle too. You know, I was at that dinner table and people was passing by, you know, baked chicken, because I used to love chicken. And but more importantly, it's not even like, you know, some of the meats, it's more so the dairy and the processing of the food. You know, we don't read food labels. You look at a label and see 50 ingredients, you know, you should definitely turn the other way. But that's not how we grew up. That's not the education we receive in schools. So no one is really reading labels. So that's challenging as well. So once you know the difference between whole foods and processed foods, then the decision making becomes that much easier.
Well, implicit in what you just said is whole foods are better for you. I've got a number of questions. I guess the first one, yeah, in listening to nutritionists, listening to you, you just said it a couple of times in terms of what you were saying. You know, we said, well, eat more whole grains. Yeah. My question is, what is a whole grain?
Yeah.
I mean, what kind of food is that?
Right. Well, here's a scary thought. Only 2% of Americans meet the recommended daily allowance for fiber. You know, so 98% of Americans are not, which is about 40 to 45 grams of fiber a day, which is one of the reasons we have chronic diseases like collateral cancer or colon cancer, because people are not getting the amount of fiber they need. Fiber also pushes out cholesterol. So we have, you know, heart disease is the number one killer of Americans. So these simple educational facts will really help save lives. But to your point, people don't really know what the whole food is. So a whole grain are your brown rices, you know, things with the germ, with the wheat. For example, white rice is nothing but brown rice. Now it's bleach. So, you know, your body is treating white rice like sugar and glucose, opposed to the fiber, which releases sugar slowly. And it keeps your blood, when we eat foods that are stripped down up and down, and that can lead to the propensity to things like diabetes. So whole grains, for example, quinoa, their brown rice, millet, you know, wheat breads. Some people are allergic to wheat because of the gluten, but that's people with celiac disease. You know, and only 2% of people, Americans, have celiacs. The other individuals who, like, I'm gluten-free, are just kind of on a, they just ride in the gluten-free wave. Millet, things like that, farro, but those are foods we traditionally have not eaten. And then again, every vegetable, every fruit is full of fiber.
Well, I guess my other question is, when you're talking about making these changes, and we're changing attitudes, really, what's the biggest complaint you hear from folks as they're going through the process? What's the biggest challenge that a lot of them have? You talk about some folks who go hard and then have to back off because they don't have the willpower. What's the biggest challenge you're hearing from folks who are making these changes?
The fact that they feel like it's being forced, you know, like someone's directing them, you know, to change 30, 40, 50, 60 years of a certain way of living. And a lot of people don't like being boxed in like that. They don't. It's kind of the same thing with parenting. No parent wants you to tell them how to raise their child, either though it could be very great parental advice. Everyone has their own, you know, set of rules for raising their child. But it's the same thing in the food industry. You know, people have their habits. They know what they like. They know what their body wants. Not necessarily that is good for their body, but that's just what they're used to. They don't want to make the change cognitively, you know. So physically, they might say, oh, okay, I understand, you know, that some apples and some almond butter may be a better choice than a grilled cheese, but I don't have the taste buds for that. And I don't want you to tell me that I should be eating that because I know what I want. So that's really the most challenging part. And what I pride myself in doing is being there, you know, growing up in the inner city, on government cheese, powdered milk. You know, I'm talking about cheese that didn't melt. You know, you cut a slice off and like, you got that thing on the stove for like 30 minutes. Of course.
We're in the rack and eat it.
So coming from, you know, that arena to this arena, I feel like I can relate to their challenges and able to explain and help that better, opposed to having a silver spoon and being like, no, do this, and that. So I understand their challenges, but it just takes that willpower. And like I said, that education is key. You know, people have to hear this information, you know, 10, 15, 20, 25 times. It's not like, you know, you go into a lifestyle visit or sit down with with a nutritionist for one session and you walk away like, well, that's it, my life has changed. It takes repeated information and experiences, and also environment. You have to convene where people have like minds. You know, you have to go to, you know, the Saturday morning organic farmers markets. You have to, you know, sit down at the cafes or the smoothie shops and just watch other people's trends who are also trying to make that change, because then, you know, you start picking up on some of those cues, and then little by little, you'll want more of that. But if you never change the environment, then you're really not going to be able to change, you know, the thought process that leads to choosing grapes over chips.
Nakamani, yeah. I know you started out with fathers. When did you decide to incorporate the family?
Well, either though the name itself was targeting dads, you know, the premise was that if dads focus more on nutrition and the matriarchal roles of the household, then the child has a greater propensity of growing up with these habits already learned, opposed to relearning them at 30, 35, like I had to do. But a lot of fathers, you know, really don't take that role or don't want that role. They want to leave it, you know, to the wife or the female, the family. Or if it's a single father, it may be even more challenging. So that was really the goal, for dads to really step up and take control decision-making process of the family. And what I saw was that at our event, you know, 50% of the events were females, you know, along with the children. So we were like, you know what, we need to start catering to them as well and making them feel comfortable in our environment. So we started adding things like Zumba and planks to some of the fitness workouts. You don't really have to change the messaging with the nutrition, because it's all the same whether you're a man, female, or child. The only real difference is that there's a different set of steps needed for breast cancer, for example, and certain foods that women should be eating more of for breast cancer, like broccoli, which has a certain set of phytochemicals that fight against cancer genes, and also omega-3s, which also help fight against breast cancer, which is a hormone-based cancer, just like prostate is a hormone-based cancer. So if you can stop the fluctuation of your hormones, which are affected heavily by dairy, then you have a better propensity of being able to educate, whether it's men or women, on their diets, you know, to prevent those two cancers.
You know, in listening to you, it almost sounds, the thing that caught my ear was basically when you said you have to, in so many words, you said you have to change your philosophy. In a way, that reminds me of when I quit smoking.
Mm-hmm.
There was information I read to let me know, you know, what to expect. If I fell off, get right back on. It even went so far as to ask me, why did I smoke? I figured, and through a simple questionnaire, I figured out these days anyway, or back then, the only reason I smoked was one, it was a habit. It was a habit, a physical habit, and a psychological habit. Implicit in that is I didn't even enjoy it anymore. I was like, whoa, I don't even like this. But anyway, back to what you're saying, because like I said, I really, I'm angry with me because I actually threw a bag of potato chips away. You know, that's not to say I won't go buy another bag tomorrow. You know, but I threw it away. That's the first time I've ever done that. And I guess what I'm asking is there some sort of information that I, along with other people who are serious about changing their eating habits. In listening to you, your eating habit, the operative term there is habit, not eating. You know, it's habit in terms of what you're used to eating. Is there any kind of information? I mean, I'm not talking about a book, maybe a booklet or something, you know, to let you know what to expect. And so not so much how to change it, but what to do. Because as you said, you know, I won't say I don't like grapes, but if I've got a choice between potato chips and getting some grapes, I'm not going to even consider the grapes. I'm going to get the chips. Lightly salted, but still, I'm sure they're just bad.
I'm not saying a bag of chips is going to kill you, but, you know, for me, for example, my household, like, we ate chips every day. You know, my mom, my dad, me, my sisters, all of us all had to have our own bag of chips. And this is every single day. You know, so that's different than, you know, once a week or something, you have a bag of chips or a handful of chips. It's really just breaking out of that habit, thinking that I need a smoke or I need chips or I need a candy bar every single day. But one of the strongest resources that I've utilized and has helped me out, his name is Dr. Neil Barnard, and he started PCRM.org, which stands for the Physicians Committee for Responsible Medicine. And what he did was he challenged his industry to be more responsible for how they educate their patients. Because, for example, doctors will give you all this advice and then go and not follow their own advice. You know, and they also were not and still do not offer nutritional advice on disease prevention and weight control. They always send you to the pharmacy. And we know the reasons why there. You know, so he started PCRM, which is a organization of over 100,000 doctors. But also his website talks more about nutrition and has steps on how to break habits. Has recipes for each day to guide you along. You know, once you break that 21 day, then it's a secondary program, you know, to keep you going as well. And then most of their graphics are very friendly. It breaks down those complicated medical terms into layman terms, you know, for the everyday consumer. So again, that's PCRM.org. And you're going to find an array of information out there. And that's kind of the problem, too, because people are getting really confused. You know, things come about like South Beach diet, you know, paleo, veganism, flexitarian. You know, people just don't know, you know, what to follow. You know, so that's why I say do the education for yourself and then determine what you think would be the best program. As long as you're incorporating the whole grains, the fruits, the vegetables, and, you know, a handful of seeds and nuts. Because, for example, we're supposed to be eating 5 to 7 pieces of fruit and veggies daily. But, you know, most people are just getting in 1 or 2. So how would they have known that?
Well, that's true. And, you know, for me, and I consider myself relatively healthy, I don't eat 5 to 6 pieces of fruit a week. Let's not talk about the day. Right. It's not happening.
Yeah.
You know?
Go ahead, Frank.
No, go ahead. No, please.
Wake up, Russ.
Here's the thing. Talking to me about all this is like trying to describe blue to a blind man. But I'm taking it in. I'm soaking it in.
Russ, it means that you just have to be careful about which beers you drink.
Yeah, right. You know, a lot of people who are trying to be healthy, and like Hamadi said, you have to change your mindset. And like the 21 day of consistently doing something is a start. You know, it's not the end, but it is a start. It's a goal that you can go after. But after 21 days, then you have a better chance of breaking the habit. And that's why they have like the 21 day thing. I heard a stat about a month ago, some physicians were on TV talking about health. And I think in medical school, doctors get less than 40 hours of training in nutrition.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
All they want to do is give you a pill to do this and a pill to do that, when probably, like Kamatni said, changing your diet could take the place of a pill. You know, you can become pill-less. You don't have to take anything. Not only that, it saves you a lot of money, because this medication, once you get on it, people think that they have to stay on it forever. And in most cases, you don't have to stay on it forever. There is a finite period when you can get off of a lot of medication. But nobody tells the person that's taking the medication, hey, at some point if this changes here, you can stop doing this. I have a question, come on. I know you said Father's Day is your big day for Fit Fathers. Exactly what is the program for Father's Day? What do you all do?
Yeah, so it's called Fit Father's Day, and it's twofold. One is to, you know, reach men nationally and families nationally with a challenge, you know, to on Father's Day, you know, start becoming more aware, start doing more exercises with the family, start eating more nutritionally, start drinking more water over sodas and sugary drinks, choosing, you know, whole grains over bleached grains. And, you know, putting in 30 to 60 minutes, you know, 4 to 5 days a week, you know, so that's the national message. And then from a local message, we have group fitness events. For example, in Atlanta, we have a spin class, which you should probably join, Greg. You know, it's Soul Cycle, and this one's on Saturday. So it's a group of fathers and men. And they take an indoor spending class. And last year was the first time we did it in Atlanta. It was an amazing turnout. We filled the room. Every bike was taken. And everyone had a great time. And everyone socializing and just celebrating, you know, Father's Day weekend with one another. In D.C., where we spearheaded the event, it's a grander event. We're at an outdoor plaza downtown Silver Spring. So we have 3 fitness trainers leading group workouts of a couple hundred people. We have vendors. We have fitness contests. And we're giving out over $2,500 in prizes. So we have partners like Nike, Yokohama gave us a set of tires for the Mr. Fit Father contest. It's just pretty amazing that all these brands are being a part of this greatness, because the whole idea is that on Father's Day, don't just go to brunch and eat as much as you want, but, you know, wake up, do something energetic, spend time with the family, and then go eat, you know, but be cognizant of how much you do eat, because, you know, your stomach is only the size of your palm, and people don't realize that. So
you touched on something there, thing about eating. In our culture, all of our cultures, you know, a lot of important events center around food and dining, whether it's Thanksgiving, Christmas, Easter, 4th of July, you know, a lot of milestones in our lives are focused around eating. And, you know, I think part of the issue is, while there may be a desire to correct your eating habits, to change your habits, to borrow Frank's term, is also the social pressure of Aunt so-and-so shared all this food, and they're going to be very upset with you if you don't eat it, or at least sample some of it. And that's, I think, the real cultural pressure that a lot of folks go into, no matter what community you come from. Russ, I know you go out to see your family out in the West, and I know you just don't sit there and drink water.
I don't.
But it's the whole thing of the whole cultural social pressure to partake, to share the meal, because it's a bonding experience as well. And that requires some shift in thinking, I would imagine.
Yeah, you know, especially in Europe, you know, where they have these extended dinners and, you know, the dinner is based around long conversation. You know, so one of the things I suggest, you know, because I do the same thing, like when we go home for Thanksgiving, we know we're going to eat more than we typically do. I make sure, one, that I take a fast a few days before. Two, that I get in a very extended workout the morning of. And then three, if we do decide to stuff ourselves, then that next day we go on another small little fast and put in a workout that's twice as, you know, challenging. Because the thing about calorie intake is that individuals may not be aware that one meal is, you know, 900,000 calories, and that a typical 45-minute workout may be only 350 calories burned. So you really never, mathematically, you really never balance in that caloric intake, you know, so you have to work twice and three times as hard to burn it off. So if you go into it knowing that, you have a better chance of not putting on pounds, you know, after those special occasions. But again, this is really for like people and individuals that's already fitness and nutritionally focused. So it's even more challenging for those that are not in that space. And, you know, they go into celebrations, you know, with the thought that, you know, I'm going to eat as much as I want. I'm going to drink as much as I want because it's a festive activity. So there's really no sound recipe for that. It just is what it is. Just slowly but surely, we just have to keep influencing one another. Like when I'm at our family occasions, I may subtly suggest a few things like, hey, Kay, why don't you have some more such and such? And I'm like, no, you know, because, you know, I'm not trying to gain, you know, an extra 3 pounds. You know, I'm full and focused, et cetera, et cetera. But, you know, then people, they do look at you funny. I lost a lot of friends, I'm not going to lie, who thought my lifestyle was too different and unique from what it used to be when I was with them. And a lot of them thought I wasn't cool enough after I changed. So you got to be ready for that sacrifice too, which, but now it's paid off because some of those same individuals have come back and be like, hey, you know, I just had a diabetic scare. You know, I need to start listening to what you were saying, what I need to do.
Well, I look at people like that as, first, they weren't your true friends in the first place. You know, true friends go through the ups and downs with you, and they don't really judge you based on lifestyles. You know?
Right.
And when you have an event, I know you have women there, you have men there, you probably have obese, all run the gamut. You have people who, like you said, have allergies like the gluten and everything. You probably have people who have cancer or on the verge of having cancer, maybe dealing with some diabetes, or they're pre-diabetic. How involved is the medical community with you at these events?
Oh man, it's very involved. For example, last year's ambassador was a young lady. She was 13 years old, named Journey Butler, who out of nowhere came down with a very rare cancer called RMC. And it happens to kids with the sickle cell gene. And their parents both have sickle cell, but they wasn't aware that that gene could lead to RMC. And
I did my paper in college on sickle cell. Go ahead.
And the survival rate is very dire for RMC. So she did pass away last year, and her mother, of course, started a nonprofit in her honor. So now, Fit Father's Day, the awareness is all about sickle cell and helping people understand what that means. If you have the trait, you know, what you can do and how to live with it. You know, so for example, I mentioned Children's Hospital is one of our partners. and we have we have screenings at our events, you know, for high blood pressure. Sometimes we have pre-diabetic screenings, you know, to test your A1C. Because people don't realize, you know, that number, if it goes over 5.7, then that puts you into, diabetic, atmosphere. But then again, most people don't get tested or screenings or get blood work. So that's another, you know, set of challenges as well. So our whole goal is to help educate on disease prevention. So we've always, made sure that the medical community was on the forefront of our programs.
Now you have these programs across the country. Is each program the same in different locations?
No, they're all different, and it really depends on what the dire circumstances are of that community. So we look at that. You know, for example, we're going to go to Detroit this summer, and because diabetes is high in Detroit, so we're going to go there in August and host a couple of events. So it's really based on what the needs of the community are. You know, it may be obesity, it may be diabetes, or it may just be high blood pressure. So yeah, it just is. You know, it's no different than test driving, you know, our cars and sitting down and coming up with our opinions on that how that technology worked in our particular circumstance and how we think it might fit in that consumer's lifestyle. It's the same way with food, nutrition, and disease prevention.
Do you know exactly when you're going to be in Detroit in August?
I think it's the third week in August. I'll definitely let you know. They're putting the programming together now. You'll get my first invite, Frank.
Okay. And along those lines, have you tried to team up? When you know, I was actually thinking about the local chapter of the NABJ here, as a mechanism to get some publicity,
I have not thought about that. You know, it's an impeccable idea.
Yeah,
In fact, I'm gonna volunteer you for reaching out and getting the contact for me.
Oh, thank you very much.
well, Greg, Greg is the secretary of the NABJ, right, Greg?
I'm the treasurer. I'm the money.
Oh, he's the treasurer.
I don't mind reaching out, because the point of it is he's the treasurer of the national organization, which doesn't, I won't say doesn't, but what you're trying to do is get down to the blocks, so to speak,
the grassroots level,
grassroots of the situation. So you need the locals.
Yes.
And Detroit has a very, very good local.
Very active, strong chapter, and they would love to do that. In fact, Kamatni, something to think about. Next summer, NABJ will be in Detroit for our national convention.
Mm. Yeah, because it moves around. Okay. Yeah.
Right. This summer we're in New Orleans, but next summer we'll be in Detroit. So there may be some synergy, because when you get 3,000 journalists in one place and you start talking about fitness, you've got a better way to amplify your story.
Exactly. Okay. Something to think about.
Yeah, we have two of the journalists that are on here on a regular basis are the presidents of what is it, press associations.
Jill?
Like, well, Chris is president.
Jill and Chris are the president, so they can also possibly, you know, do some things to get the message out.
But okay.
One final question for me, Kamati. I know when you started doing this, the car companies gave you a bunch of grief as well as the rest of us. And some of us still give you grief in jest. Not.
Yeah, he's speaking right now.
Yeah, right, exactly. I tease you all the time, but I'm very serious, and I like what you're doing, and I had to get my lifestyle had to change because of two cancers that I had, and a lot of times it's something like that that makes you change your eating habits and other things.
Right.
But my doctor also and my nutritionist told me you can do things in moderation. And to me, moderation is the key. It's not like you said before. I don't want to feel forced to do anything.
Right.
But anyway, back to the car companies. I think initially the car companies felt that they were forced to do something when it came to mealtime because of some of the things that you wanted, which was vegan as a part of the diet. How has that attitude of the car companies changed now?
Oh, man, tremendously. Now you'll see on the forums, there's like four or five options that you can choose from for a dietary staple, whether it's vegan, vegetarian, or paleo. So a lot of them internally have come to me and said that I broaden their horizon, because we are so unique and we all have, you know, specific requirements. And, you know, some said there are some journalists that's a little bit more outrageous than even myself with their choices. So they really had no choice, but, you know, they feel better about doing it because, again, they're in a position, you know, to help us with what we need is energy, you know, to test drive their product. It's a long day of driving, and a lot of us don't get much sleep from a night's drinking. So the best way to offset that is, nutritional food in the morning. So
stop pointing at Russ.
hey, leave Russ alone. Russ does everything in moderation.
But anyway, go ahead.
So, for example, my girl Katie Reber from Chrysler is the number one advocate of individual food choices. So anytime I go on a Chrysler event, she will make sure there's not only vegan food, but that there's multiple vegan options. Because the sad thing is that as a vegan, there may be just the one option. So unlike you guys, where if you want steak, fish, or chicken and you get to choose, I only get to choose one thing. And sometimes I'm not up for a portobello mushroom burger. So she makes sure that there's multiple choices. If you provide it, they will come. So you will see that mostly everyone is eating that food as well, because everyone loves their vegetables. But if you have it for them, And it makes that choice much easier. So it's not like the food is just sitting there. Their food goes just as quick as the non-vegan food as well. So they've done an amazing job, and they continue to commend me on helping them. So it just feels good, not only touching the consumer, but also, you know, the business-to-business connection.
Great. Any other questions, Guy?
One. What is paleo?
Well, paleo is ancient caveman theory that we were hunters and hunters and gatherers, and that the majority of the diet should be meat and no grains, but also vegetables and fruits, and also no dairy. So it's kind of like just the reverse of veganism, just like an electric car is the reverse of of a gasoline vehicle.
Okay.
So right. We're knuckle draggers, basically.
Okay. Yeah, right.
Yes.
It's called grazing. Kay, I want to thank you for taking the time to come on the show. You know, I've been trying to get you on here for quite a while. And you finally, I guess I finally wore you down and you decided to do it. But great information. All I can say, I appreciate what you've been doing in the industry. You know, I'm always following what you're doing on the auto side as well as with the Fit Fathers. I'm sure you have a long-range goal for Fit Fathers. Why don't you end the show basically by telling us what's the long-range goal for Fit Fathers?
Basically, the long-term goal is to make it a household brand. You know, we would like chapters in across the country in all the major cities and even in rural counties as well. We just want dads to make more helpful decisions and play a stronger role in the uprearing of the child, with nutrition being their number one asset and their number one target goal. And, you know, just to keep posting our events, what we call social workouts, to the point where I don't have to be the number one source. I would like it to be diversified and spread out evenly amongst an array of different Fit Fathers who share the same goals, same passion, and the same intuition as I do. And you can go to our website, which is simply fitfathers.com, or Fit Fathers on any of the social media platforms for more information on what we're doing nutritionally and fitness-wise. So thanks for having me. I definitely appreciate this, gentlemen.
Great, man. I appreciate the information. Anytime you want to come back on and update us, let me know. If you have a program you want me to promote, you know, just shoot me an email and I'll be more than happy to do it. One of the things I like doing is promoting what other journalists are doing that's really not auto-related all the time. You know, we talk about other things. Thanks, Kay. Take care, man.
See you. Thanks, Botany.
All right, man.
Take care, buddy.
All right.
Okay, guys, we have a couple of recalls to deal with. About 1.25 million Ram trucks were recalled for software errors could cause the seat belt pretensioner in a rollover to not activate. And that's the 2014 through 2016 model line. Go on the NHTSA website, look up recalls. That's the best place to go. I think it's NHTSA.gov, and you can check out the recalls. We have another one. Volkswagen is expanding its recall to 292,000 Porsches and Audis, guys. Porsches and Audis for a fuel pump defect that could cause a fire. And I don't know whether you've seen on the news. I think they actually showed one of those cars just going up in flames for, looks like, no potential for no potential reason. 2012 through 2017 models, you take the car to the dealership, make an appointment, go. If it's something that they can do with the fuel pump, they have what they call a wrap that they can put on the fuel pump, which may solve the problem. If that doesn't solve the problem, they will actually replace the fuel pump. And that came from a Bloomberg report. We talk a lot about recalls, and recalls, at least in my area now, look like every other day on the news, they start mentioning some kind of a recall. So I think the media outlets are starting to see the importance of letting consumers know what's going on out there with all these automobiles on the road that have potential problems. So anybody have something they want to end the show on that's a positive note?
Yeah, I'm going to go eat a piece of celery.
That's a good start. Now, my only question is, will that be in a Bloody Mary?
Yeah, right.
No.
All right, since you all want, I will. Volvo and Liberty Mutual Insurance has partnered for Volvo owners that switch over to Liberty Mutual for home or auto, they could possibly save up to $509 on their insurance premium over a year. And Liberty Mutual will start using Volvo official parts in replacements of Volvos that may be in an accident and the parts have to be replaced.
That's a win-win for both sides.
Yes. That is. I heard something interesting today talking about insurance. Right now, with all these new cars and all the technology that's in these cars, especially the airbag situation that we've been talking about for years, more and more cars now are being totaled in an accident instead of repairs being made. That is going to, I think, increase the salvage business, which means they will have more quality parts for you to choose from when you go to the salvage yard, because a car may be totaled by the insurance company because you may have 9 airbags in the front that go off, and it's pretty much, that's the car. It's gone, along with the frontal crash. So you end up, salvage companies will end up with a lot of quality parts. They can make some extra money on us.
Well, that's also the reason why, despite cars being much safer today than they were even 5 years ago, insurance rates aren't going down. They're actually going up. And right. That's why, is because all this technology costs so much to fix. And either, whether they fix it or total the car, in either event, it's a huge expense. It's a huge loss for the insurance company. So, you know, that's an issue.
Yep. Anyway, I want to thank Kamat. I know he's gone, for coming on the show. Appreciate all the time he took and all the good information that he gave us. I'm sure we all were educated a little bit. And I want to thank the journalists, the regulars who are here most of the time, giving up their hour or so to join in the show and give you all that's viewing this some good information. As always, please buckle up. Don't drink and drive. Always please buckle up. Don't text and drive. See you next time.
Bye.
Take care, everybody.